So we will talk about what is IoT, which you have been already familiar. So just two or three sentences about it. And one of the topics that we also want to get very comfortable with is the data explosion and what kind of data actually is in the exploding part. Okay, so that understanding is very key to understanding the architectures, not only of IoT, but a lot of other several different data related architectures that move data and refine data and also do the analytics. Okay, and we'll also see some of the challenges and what are the options that are available. Okay, so one thing I deliberately kept out of scope is some of the hardware implementations of the storage, which means like what are some of the companies' versions of their database options. So that I've kept it as a black box because that may be very deeper and may not be relevant at this point. Okay. Okay. So we all know about IoT. Okay. So it is basically interconnected physical devices. Okay. So that you have already seen in the last 2 days. Okay. So these devices could be any device that senses information, or it can also be the other end. You can actuate certain things. For example, even 10 years back, I could switch on a particular light or fan in a building, not being present there. Somewhere out in a different country, I can go to the control panel, and I have software control switches that can be used to actuate certain devices. Okay, so sensing and actuation, both sides are there. Both sides are there. But majority of the devices are sensing devices, which give us information about the state of equipment, or it could be an audio signal, or it could be an image, or a moving camera. Okay, so it could be anything. Normally, some thermal sensors and other things. So that percentage is more. Okay, so more than 70% would be that kind, where you receive data to the centralized server or a cluster. And the actuators are very less. Okay, so actuators, even if they are there, our job may be the frequency of actuation may be very, very infrequent. Okay, so you may be switching on in the morning and then switching off in the night. Okay, so the amount of data that you control is less compared to the amount of data that you receive and process. Okay, so every device is either capable of collecting and transferring information or being actuated by some command that's coming from one of the control systems. Okay, so that is how actually most of the IoTs are done. So the very concept of a distributed system that you have started getting used to, just let me put a small pointer here. So a few things that we need to be very, very clear. Okay, so that is, so the scenario 10 years back, and now, okay. So we have gone through a lot of transition and a lot of transformations in the data landscape, okay. So let me put a few pointers here, okay. So back then, most of the data was structured. Most of the data was structured. And most of the data processing happened in a batch mode. That means every day night, it will start processing. And in the morning, the data will be ready. If you compare against that, now the scenario has changed a lot. We have structured, semi-structured, and unstructured. Okay. And we are not just processing batch mode, we are also processing messages and real-time data apart from batch data. So this is normally called as the streaming mode. Okay, the streaming mode. So earlier also it was there, but it was very, very small component. Streaming was very less. Real-time data processing was very, only few companies really had the need for real-time analytics, maybe 5% of the companies. But now majority of the companies have this as their primary need. Okay. And the data that we had was very less, like maybe 20% or less. But now at least 50%, you can say, is falling in this category by volume, not by number of records, by volume. Okay. And currently we are adding more of social media data. Okay, so this is the scenario. Okay, so this is from the data perspective. Okay, so when we say semi-structured data, we are talking about XML and JSON formats. Okay, Java Server Object Notation. All right. So if you have any questions, architectures. Okay. So what do you think changed in the architecture? Is there any change that you can see visibly in the architecture of the ETL and data warehouse systems and analytic systems back then and now, at least from your understanding from your literature study and also from attending other seminars? So what do you think has changed in the last few years? Can I get some points related to that, the architectural difference?
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, what I think that in earlier human-to-human communication is much more focused, and now we are focusing on machine-to-machine independently communicating each other. Means we are concentrating on this concept.
Correct. Yeah. So the number
what I feel is the major difference between earlier age and now is like now machine is going to be independent and talking to each other without any intervention of humans.
Right. Yeah. So as you rightly pointed out, there is a lot of automation going on, and whatever can be automated must be automated. That is the philosophy we always follow. So even if you see software, so for example, let's say I am a company. I am actually trying to at LinkedIn and become friends with people who are related to that, or people who can give me some kind of leverage. If they have some 2,000 contacts, if I become their friend, then they can be my second contact either. So we used to pay people. I will hire a person to sit there and do every day LinkedIn processing actually. But now for that we have bots. Okay, not only for hardware. Even for software development, we have bots. For example, I want to create a website. Okay. So there are lot of small companies that are coming to the fore. What they do is they take your requirement. Instead of they sitting and developing, 80 to 85% of the code is created by bot. Okay. Just I'm not talking about Wix and other things. I'm also talking about small companies that are doing nowadays. So they take your requirements. Now 80% is done. Only the front end or the user interface, the aesthetic value or the art that you want to do, that changes. So everything else is done. All the coding is actually done by bots. Okay. So everywhere you see, we are trying to So that is a very good point. Changes happened because of two reasons. Okay. So one of the reason is that the data growth. We are seeing a lot of data growth, both in terms of the number of records as well as in the volume of the records. Let us say the number of records. So let's say a bank customer is there. Okay. So let us assume that every year we are getting some 10% new customers. So that means there'll be 10% new record. So we can say the number of record growth is 10%, but the data volume growth is more than 60%. Okay, so last year I had 100,000 customers. This year I'm having 110,000 customers. But the volume, if I see, last year it was 1 terabyte. Just an example. This year it is 1.6 terabytes. That means 60% growth in the volume compared to the 10% growth in the records. Okay, so this again comes from the semi-structured and unstructured data. Unstructured data meaning huge text files, video clips, audio clips, images, okay, all those things. So one of the reasons for the architecture change is the data growth. We used to have, let's say, we used to process 30 million records every hour. In a telephone company, and with a volume of around 120 GB of data per hour. Okay, 120 GB of data per hour. Okay. Now this has increased tremendously. This has increased tremendously, and the same case is visible in all the lines of business, be it insurance, retail, healthcare, education, transportation, everywhere. Okay. So now to handle the olden data, I just need some 3 or 4 servers, maybe 4 servers maximum. Typically the ETL tools like Informatica, DataStage or SSIS, they used a kind of distributed, or we call it as parallel system, parallel processing system. We were not very much using the distributed system because it was not scalable really, because it came with the cost of scalability, came with the cost of every new node you add, it will be $100,000. Okay, so that is not scalability. Okay, maybe if you are a billionaire, you can say it, but for normal medium sized companies, it is not scalability. Okay, so we had to resort to distributed system, not just parallel system with 4 nodes. We wanted to have distributed systems that was not costly. Okay, so we were primarily talking about open source software to put on the distributed system. Okay, so open source started playing a big picture now. Okay, so from the last 5 years, if you see, even people who said open source is not reliable, they are now accepting that open source is the way to go. Okay, so one change we are seeing is that lot of software support or functionality from the open source side. Okay, second thing is, owing to the data types, okay, so we are seeing more of semi-structured, unstructured data, social media data, and streaming data is more. Streaming data processing was more. Earlier, it was just 10% or 15%. Now, looks like a majority of the data is going to be streaming data. So our architecture has to change, okay? So if you see, lot of software people gaining projects from data migration. So there are 4 phases of data migration and application migration. The first phase happened when we migrated our jobs from C++, Java, SQL, and scripting based platform. So primarily we are using only these kind of things, C++, Java, SQL, and scripting. Okay, so this was in the year 2000 or earlier. From here, we migrated to ETL tools. We migrated to ETL tools, which processed, so these were cursor based. That means you open the database, create a cursor, create a connection, open the database, then start from the top, read one by one, process the data. So this was time consuming. Typically when I used to work for Verizon, our jobs would run for 3 to 4 hours for each of this campaign system, consumer summary, then product systems, and transaction or CDR processing. Everything was running for 3 to 4 hours. And our production window was limited. We had a 7-hour production window and it started exceeding the production window. So we started having duplicate servers and all those things. Then nothing panned out or scaled well. So what we had to do was we had to think of alternatives. That alternative was batch processing. So batch processing means for each run, each cycle, it will take 1,000 records or 2,000 records or 5,000 records. You can change this parameter. It's called as a fetch size. You can change the fetch size. So when it reads, makes a connection to the database, in one go, it will get 5,000 records and process it in a single second. And then next, it takes another 5,000 records and then process. Not like record by record. Okay. So year 2000, not batch size. Okay. So 5,000 records. So batch size can be changed. And also it was doing the pipeline parallelism. So that means when you have multiple stages, when the third stage is doing processing on the first batch, the first day, first stage can work on the second batch or the third batch. So it was like a pipeline. Okay. So this also gives you additional advantage. So now with this kind of jobs, you are able to process records in less than 15 minutes. Okay. So from 3 hours, the job got reduced to 15 minutes. Okay. So this was the second thing. And the third migration happened when these single node or four node systems became distributed. So that is 4 or 5 years back. Okay. So primarily we are looking at Hadoop, Spark as alternatives. Okay. Instead of ETL tools. So ETL tools. So here the transition was not because of the real hardware consideration. It was really to escape the software cost. So when I say this ETL job, let's say I'm using IBM's data stage. So this was billed at more than $120,000 per node. So if I want to scale it up from 4 nodes to 8 nodes, you can think, multiply the cost. It's just mathematics. Okay. So they may have, probably give you some $500 discount. Okay, for node. So this was exorbitant. Only the big giants can afford to. Small companies and medium companies could not do it. So the third migration happened primarily for distributed systems to escape the software cost. Okay. And now the fourth migration, which is happening, already started in 3-4 years back, cloud migration. Okay. So on a need basis, not everybody has to migrate to cloud on a need basis. So some deployed private clouds, some public cloud. And some said, for the capability that I have, I want to use the private cloud. And where I do not have the capability, I want to use the public cloud. So that is the hybrid cloud. Okay. So as you see, or as you go up the ladder, 1, 2, 3, 4, you can see that the amount of streaming data has increased. Amount of IoT data has increased. Okay. Just like if you see in the olden days, solar energy was not frequently used. Okay. Solar lighters or solar water heaters, they were thought to be costly. So not many houses had. But now on a year and year basis, if you see the savings in electricity, it's huge savings. So now it has become commonplace. You can see completely solar driven airports also. Okay. So now the same way the industry is looking at the streaming data's advantage and IoT data's advantage. And you can see that there's proliferating growth of these systems. And say, obviously the architecture has to change. There is no other go for that. Okay. All right. So that is outlay of the facts that led us to where we are now in terms of the architecture and in terms of what kind of data we are consuming and we are processing. Okay. So our architecture will always have to be in this line. More open source systems, and less of proprietary tools, which are very, very costly. Okay. So not only costly, sometimes it becomes rigid. There may not be interfaces. If you have learned that particular tool, that company has started working, then you have to continue and you may be stuck one day when they close the software. Okay. Or you will be in the hands of giant software companies, which will be pleasing you when you're sleeping. Okay. All right. So this is how we have. So now if you see, many of the companies are leveraging their IoT on the cloud, or they are trying to use a distributed system, which are always free. Even the database, if you see, they don't have to go with the Oracle or SQL Server. There are always alternatives in the open source side. So many, so different areas are continuously trying to jump to the open source thing. So you can look at different applications of IoT. Okay, so from simple sensors to continuously monitored systems, and also sometimes we look at a manufacturing plant sending millions of IoT data transactions per second. Okay, so there are so many parts, moving parts, they can continuously get monitored, and it is stored also. Okay. So one of the key things about the IoT is that it has a unique ID. It is a distinct resource ID, URI. Okay, just like the IP address of the system or the URL of the websites, you have the resource ID. Okay, so this resource ID can be used to pinpoint a particular sensor or actuator. Okay. So the data explosion happened in different areas. IoT also is a contributing factor. Okay. So if you look at data growth, we are looking at data being doubled every year, at least getting doubled. Okay. And from an IoT side, we are looking at roughly 35 billion devices connected to the internet as we speak. Okay. So out of this, roughly 25 billion is estimatedly IoT devices, pure IoT devices, and the remaining 10 billion are normally the smartphone, tablets, and commonly used smartwatches. Okay, so even though they are also IoT, can be considered as IoT, we are not talking about sensors and actuators. We are talking about more of devices. Okay, so even these devices send a lot of data. Okay, so even it could be a private data, like you may have taken a photo of your own family member, but that has to go and store in some server, or you may be sending to some of your friends, and that transmission takes place in the some server or the other. Essentially, finally, it lands in some server temporarily or permanently. Okay, maybe Google Drive or Google Photos or wherever it is. Okay. So this is the growth of IoT devices estimated at 2025. Okay, around 80 zettabytes of data. Okay, you can look at the zettabyte scale or the petabyte terabyte scale on the Wikipedia. It is huge amount of data. Okay, and it is almost like every year it is actually this data that we are looking at for IoT and streaming data is on the rise. Okay. And it is estimated to be having a 41.6 billion devices, IoT devices. Okay, so they will come up with new conventions for naming them also. Okay. So these are some of the players who support IoT on the cloud. Okay, so obviously you can see the big three: Azure, Google Cloud, and AWS. Okay, so they are in the forefront of many of the cloud related offerings of functionality. Okay, like data processing, database storage of different types, and machine learning, then big data, the blockchain, like that. There are so many, so even the continuous integration, continuous deployment, and infrastructure and hardware management. So everything is offered. IoT is not an exemption. Okay, so IoT is also there. Along with that, you can also look at Cisco, Oracle, EMC. So those companies are also big players. And now you can see the majority of the share, market share, is taken by the first three or four players. The remaining 20% or so is split across other competitors. Okay, so there are countless number of providers for cloud and IoT on the cloud. This is a small list actually I picked. Okay, so these are some of the common scenarios. Okay, so there are a lot of scenarios that we are not normally familiar with. Okay, for different, for example, let's say there's a bottling factory for Coca-Cola. So they will have lots and lots of IoT sensors for filling, for putting the cap, putting the labels. So the entire pipeline is having IoT sensors. Okay, so in the manufacturing, automobiles, environmental and geological area, wearable devices, okay, smart cities, okay, and biometrics, and shipping and transportation is a huge area where a lot of things are there, and supply chain management. So, for example, if you look at Big Bazaar, whatever is being moved from the source location to the shops and being on the shelves, okay. So everything is actually being monitored by these IoT devices. Okay, so even these systems that have vending machines, no? These vending machines are nowadays, earlier people note down how much. So we went to the Coca-Cola system and they showed us this thing. Now that is completely AI driven. The filling of the vending machine itself is AI driven. So it takes a picture and sends to the centralized server. And there it identifies how many pieces are there in stock in each shelf and each slot. And whatever is reduced, they will send the order, and almost everything is automated. Only the person has to come and open it and just place it. Nothing else is required. Okay. So you will see that even domestic houses, people who are now tech savvy, they started fitting their houses with a lot of automated power saving systems and security systems. Small hobbies also they have started. Okay, so there is no limit to the areas where the IoT can be used. Okay, so as I was saying earlier, it is both sides, not only consuming the data, also sending data to control these devices. Okay, again, these are most of the time automated, but sometimes it could be interfered with some kind of supervisory roles for a human system. For example, in the fleet management, okay, it's a cargo and fleet management or taxi service, okay. So sometimes automation is available, but sometimes you have to tell a particular driver that you don't stand here, you go to the city location where there's more people waiting like that. Okay, so those kind of small interventions is possible, but that is not a major impediment to the automation process itself. Okay, and also there are new devices coming. Okay, so new devices and new systems that are coming, and so if you see that increasingly automation, the concept of smart city, not in a complete level, but in small levels. Okay, so a particular area of a city is made as a smart city, completely automating things and energy saving, especially. Okay, so all those things are happening, and that's on the rise, or completely automated and solar powered airports or the railway stations, like the bus stops. Okay, so because we don't want to save. We don't want to spend unwantedly on things that can be automated. Let's say the scenario of, there are street lights. We have employed two people to go and off the street lights every day. So that is a big cost to the corporation. Okay. So that is how they start off with the automated lighting system. So at when the daylight is sufficiently lit, then it will all off the systems. Okay. So like that, everywhere we are seeing a reduction of manpower and reduction of cost, which can be replaced by a simple sensor. Maybe it is just 5 rupees. We just have to automate the process and consume the data. Okay. So that is going on in every area and every country as well. So these are some common IoT data, RFID. Okay. So this is there in all the items that can be tagged. Okay. In the supply chain management, we do it. In sending pharma products, we do it. In sending goods to the grocery stores or the supermarkets, so RFID is there. Every blood sachet that is in the blood bank, that is having an RFID. Okay. So in many countries, we are providing solutions where we can tag the source of the blood that is coming. Okay, which hospital or even the which donor. That's a unique ID, and the RFID is playing a big role in these things. And now there are also RFIDs getting attached to your identity card, like for example, the driver license or the things. So you are remotely identified. So when you walk in a particular store, you are identified, and if you have authorized your identification to be automated, so based on that, it may connect to your card and it may do the billing, and everything can be automated. Okay. Passports are getting RFID like that. Okay. And environmental data is a big thing. Okay. So even sensor data that we talked about of automobiles, and even the CVR, the cockpit voice recorder. Okay. So they're all actually IoT data. Okay. And we are now monitoring the traffic lights. Okay. And movement of people, and also identification of suspected felons and terrorists. So all these things are continuously being monitored with the help of artificial intelligence systems and ML also in a big way. And patient management system, patient sensor data, which monitors critical vitals signals from a patient who is under observation post-surgery, or a particular patient of a disease, important disease like that. Okay. So why I'm pulling this off is because some of these are more critical data. The critical in the sense that accuracy is very important, or the security is very important, or the timeliness in which it is processed is very important. Okay. So suppose there is a credit card fraud happening. You say a person has stolen a person's credit card, and we have not tagged that person as a thief or somebody, but we have tagged the transaction as, let's say it is a transaction is actually a suspicious transaction. A person used to buy normally for less than 5,000 rupees, suddenly he is buying for 50,000 rupees, and he is not even at the jewel store. Okay, so that raises a red flag. So immediately we have to block the transaction. So we cannot expect the transaction to be processed overnight and block it in the morning. It has to happen then and there. So now if you think of systems that are integrated, so whenever this particular thing happens, immediately the system that is capturing the CCTV on the compute counter is sending the signal back to the police station for some verification. So then you can understand that this is a person who is on the wanted list, and you can send somebody to arrest him. Okay. So another thing, that whether you like it or not, big way of integration is going on. Okay. So just let me give you a very simple example of integration. Let us say in a lot of governments or a lot of the countries, the fleet, the transportation fleet is integrated. Okay, it's a very simple example where IoT devices can come together to help the nation. So let's say we are talking about the trucks, the 18-wheelers and all the trucks, the bus or the transportation system for the bus, trains and taxi cabs of all types, okay, and the couriers and cargo. Okay, one thing they all have is the vehicle. Okay, so if you have seen, each vehicle is fitted with a supercomputer. Every vehicle is having a computer inside, a very powerful computer. And many of the GM and other companies, they have what is called as the equivalent of a cockpit voice recorder. So CVR, the cockpit voice recorder, is actually there in a flight, and it is continuously capturing the sensor information of thousands of sensors, and also the pilot and the co-pilot and the control towers communication for the last N minutes. Okay, so it is very useful when something happens, like a mishap happens or some failure happened in some device, but still it made a safe landing. Okay, if there are such untoward instances, either small fluctuations or issues, immediately it is actually analyzed. Otherwise, it is discarded after a particular attention period. So that is a huge amount of data. Okay, so GM also has some kind of a CVR equivalent in vehicles, and if there is an accident, you can analyze what happened, and if there is a vehicle fault, to give the insurance, or it was the driver fault. Like this. Okay. So all these vehicles are having a computer. Everybody knows about it, and it is increasing. The power is increasing. They also have sensors, including cameras. Okay. So what it means is, the government can do a lot of e-governance with this. Okay. So you can do monitoring of people and vehicle. So if you know, China is actually has put a grid of cameras across the country. So a person's movement can be continuously tracked anywhere. So if you're walking from here and you're going to your office and coming back, your entire trajectory or movement is monitored. Okay, so we may not be able to do it right away in India because of democracy, but in essential points, there are more cameras. So you cannot stop a person putting a camera in his shop or in front of his house. So any crime or any, so even safety things. So if you want to monitor, you can track it. Okay, so this is one thing. Secondly, the movement of vehicles. Stolen vehicles, or there is some kind of study going on to understand the safety aspect on the roads. Okay, so we can use this fleet. So let us assume that these fleets are continuously monitored. So for example, all these fleets routes are actually optimized. Suppose I am delivering cargo from one place to another place. My route is pre-configured. So I have to spend 18 minutes for a route from point A to B. I have to do some 15 such delivery every day. Okay, so it is almost identified. The route is identified. How many minutes you stop in a particular place, how much break you can take. So your incentive is also tied to your route and tied to your time zone and other things. Okay, so if you're doing some shift after 6 o'clock in the night, then you will get some double incentive like that. So many things are combined together. So route optimization, again, we use AI to do that. And also, let us say a bus is supposed to be coming at 3:15 and to a particular place, and it was coming at 3:17. Okay. And in between, 10 vehicles were not moving at a particular location, okay, for more than 3 minutes. Not a signal light, but in a particular location, 10 vehicles were not moving. So if you have an integrated system, you can understand that using the geospatial locations, 10 vehicles are stuck at a place. Maybe there is an accident, maybe there is a roadblock, okay, or let's say in a particular area, okay, so Narsapur area, there are 20 vehicles that have owned their, it's an English word I should say, I'm sorry, have owned their wipers, not for cleaning. So if 20 vehicles at a single place, that means it is raining. Okay. So this again is an information that can be transferred to the weather station. So weather station is currently they are using such things. Okay, so they have weather sensors fitted. They don't have to rely always on the sensors. Okay, they can always use such systems, and even every vehicle can have a temperature sensor to understand the outside air temperature also. So like this, an integrated system can do countless services for the people and the country. Okay, so all is driven by IoT. So if there is a mob attack, if there's a riot, everything can be gotten even without the interference of the police. Police need not be the first source of information. The IoT devices that is on this fleet can help in a great way to do this. Okay. So now we are talking about IoT data, which is actually mobile. It is not coming from a stationary, okay? It is not coming from a stationary location. So the URI itself that you are tracking, that is moving, okay? So that needs to have some kind of connectivity. The least connectivity it should have so that it can send the data, okay? So is there any other programming or storage constraint that we are looking at here? Suppose I am looking at IoT device from a car or some kind of mobile device. Is there anything that complicates the data processing and storage here? So one is the mobility. Mobility is a problem. So that means the data itself is mobile and it has to have a system to send it back to our clusters. Okay. So suppose, let's say I have to do some processing. So we will be talking about three layers. Okay. So all the processing, majority of the processing has to happen. We call it as a central point, which is not a central point. So which is a central point in a logical term for processing. Let's say I have a Hadoop cluster or I have a MongoDB that stores and even processes the data. Okay. So this MongoDB is distributed, but the brain of the MongoDB is actually from a centralized program, a program that runs on each node. So it is a controlled from some place. Okay. So we can call it as a cluster. Instead of central point, we can call it as a cluster. So most of the programming intelligence or programming thought works, that is in a cluster, okay? But your device is in a remote location. Okay, so maybe a car or maybe a refrigerator or maybe a chainsaw or a drilling machine, something, okay? So here you cannot put too much of computing power. I cannot put an i7 there. Not feasible from a environmental condition perspective, not feasible from a cost perspective also. And also it cannot be fitted there. So I need to have a very, very small system to even capture the data. Okay. So I should technically process. Suppose I want to do analytics. Okay. So how many failures happened? How many times that room went above a particular temperature? So these analytics, the best place to do is the cluster. Okay. So when you look at tasks related to analyzing, synchronizing, and controlling. Okay. So the majority, 70 to 80% or more, should be done at the cluster. Okay. But for the data to come to the cluster, it will take some time. Okay. One thing. But not all the data has to come. So let us say I have 100 million. Transducers or sensors. I have 100 million transducers sensors from which I have to get data daily. So this will become petabytes of data. So I have to take a call on the architecture. So how much of this data has to land here? For example, let me give you a simple example. Let us say I am backing up my car. I am backing up my car and my car has a rear side camera for the car. Okay. So now it captures the data when I am backing up. Should this information, this, let's say, small video of 3 minutes is not 3 minutes, like 40 seconds is captured. Is this information, is it to be brought to the centralized server? Assume that it was a clean reverse and there was no accident or there was no hit to the bumper or anything. So there is no analysis needed for how this guy turned, did he accelerate, or a sudden brake like that. Nothing is required. So this is basically a transient information or transitory information that is just needed for that particular move. It need not be stored. So this can be removed maybe in 5 minutes and it can have the whole life in the car itself and it does not need to be sent to the cluster. Okay. And the amount of data processing that is needed is very less. So you can start the information in the car and end the information in the car. You don't have to bring it to the cluster. Okay. So this is one very important point. So not all data has to go to the cluster. Not all data has to be even transferred or need to be stored. Very important. Otherwise, if you store everything, it is something like we have all the files in our computer and we don't want to delete them. Eventually, it gets filled up and one fine day, the whole laptop crashes. Then the laptop hard disk has to be thrown out. So instead, we cultivate the habit of deleting files that are not needed then and there. Then our system will be a sane system for a long time. Okay. So managing the data and taking a call on which data has to be sent to the cluster, which data has to be residing in the endpoint, it's a very important decision. Architecture design we have to do such a way that we don't bring unwanted data. Historical data that we analyze will be based on some events only. Not every data is going to be used. Okay. But let us say some data. So suppose let us say you are traveling in the same car at a particular point, you are getting an engine heating up message. So this engine heating up message is also sensed and it is stored somewhere. So let's say the engine is getting heated up. Just 10 days back, you have made the oil change and everything, servicing. Now there is no need for an engine heating signal. So this is a very valuable information. Or let's say there's a braking, and in one side there is more pull and the other side there is less pull. So this is also a snafu that has to be recorded. Okay. So such things have to be sent to the central cluster, or the cluster actually, okay, the processing place, because you want to analyze this. It may be even historically needed for future diagnostics. So making which data has to go, which data has to stay in the cluster is very, very important. So now let us assume that there's another scenario. If I send the data to the cluster, let us assume that it will take 45 minutes for the application to analyze the data and give me back the results. Okay. Let us assume that I am having a vegetable distribution system. The government has a vegetable and fruits distribution system. And it is trying, this system is having an overall centralized cluster at Delhi. And in every state capital, there is another subsystem. And every local district, there is another subsystem. Okay. So if I want to send the data to Delhi and get it processed, it is going to take time. Okay. But let us say, what are the vegetables that have to be discarded because it is perishing? Or what are the vegetables that have to be sold today itself? And how much has not been sold? So this information has to be processed not at the endpoint, because you cannot do the endpoint things, because in a particular district, there may be many vendors. So this can be done at a district level first, okay, instead of going at a centralized level. I'm just giving an analogy. But the endpoint does not have the capability. The endpoint has simple microchip or microcontroller, and it cannot perform all the operations that are needed for the basic analytics. So you have to transport the data to a district headquarter or even a village headquarter, where there is sufficient computing, but the least it requires is a laptop or a desktop. Even that may not be there in the vehicle that is carrying the vegetables. Okay, that vehicle that's carrying the vegetable has just a few sensors. It is a gadget actually, but it is having some sensors only, not enough computing power. So normally the endpoint will have the least amount of computing power. It is not going to have a big laptop and other things. So the next point where you have the computing power and stable internet is normally called the fog system. Okay, the fog computing. That is the place where the fog computing happened. What we call about the endpoint is called the edge system. Okay, the edge system may have some computing power. Sometimes it may not be sufficiently large enough to perform a lot of analytics, a lot of processing. Okay, so we normally have three levels at least for this data to be analyzed. The edge computing or the edge nodes, which may not be having a keyboard and a laptop display at all. It may be just having computing, simple computing power, maybe some buttons, all that you have there. Okay, so edge computing has the least amount of capability for processing. Next is the fog system or the fog computing nodes. Okay, so this may be the place where you have decent place where you can have systems. Okay, may not be very powerful, may be very cheap or very ordinary computer, but internet is there and some kind of 4GB RAM or 8GB RAM is there. Okay, and then you have the cluster computing, which is at the cloud level or the on-premises system like that. Okay, so this is very, very important. When you have systems that are moving or systems that are having like a machine or something attached to machine, you may not have big kind of computing power. Okay, so we have to understand what is a fog computing. We'll come to that slide shortly. Okay, so this is the advantage of integrating multiple systems. So eventually, whether you are a private company or a private individual, some of what you are recording or some of what you are using sensors for will belong to the government. I'll give you a simple example. Let's say you are having a security system around your house. It is only for your private purpose. Nobody has to question. Okay, you are having the freedom to do it. But some crime happened, the police will be there and they will request you to give the tape to them. You cannot refuse. At that point, it becomes public property. Not public property, but the government property. So they want to have a copy of it. Okay. So likewise, all the transducers or all the sensors that you're doing, part of it at a particular time can become the property or the data can go to the hands of the government. So that has to be understood. And you cannot say, no, this is completely for my own use and all. Okay. So that is why you have these regulations, the security regulations and all kinds of safety regulations are there. So these are some of the operations that we perform on an IoT data, maybe on the edge node or maybe on the fog node or on the centralized cluster node. Okay, so acquisition is the first step, acquisition and collection of the data, consolidate and integrate the data. Okay, so consolidation means like the same data or similar data can come from multiple systems or multiple vendors. They may not have the same format. For example, customer address. One may send a full name as it is, Kiran Kumar as the full name. Another may send Kiran as the first name and Kumar as the last name. Somebody may say everything is capital. Somebody may put it as small, first letter small like that. So the data incompatibility is there. So we want to consolidate. Okay. And aggregate or group all the data together. Okay, so cleaning up, synchronization, And sometimes you may want to send back the data to actuators or transducers, analyze the data, and also do some future predictions, perform real-time analytics, edge analytics or at the site. So some kind of analytics can. So you can simply say whether the equipment's temperature is increasing or decreasing at the edge computing itself. Okay. Every 5 minutes you are capturing some in analytics. And okay, compared to last 5 minutes, the temperature has increased to two centigrade more. That means it needs some cooling fluid. Let us allow some cooling fluid. Okay. Like that, you can do some edge computing and edge analysis at the site itself. And another important aspect is to store and distribute the data. Store and distribute the data. So that is also a thing. So even every single point has a lot of discussion around it, but we don't have to do it right away. But if you are implementing certain things, you will be performing a lot of code and lot of architectural analysis for every section of it. Okay, so this will be the complete life cycle of the IoT data. So also there's one more point, which is the retention period. How long you have to retain the data. Okay, suppose the machine information is there, or the room information of a particular shop is there. How long you have to retain? Maybe 3 months, maybe 6 months, like that. Okay. So you will put it in some kind of cheap information storage. Okay. So in AWS you have S3 and Glacier. So archival can be done on the Glacier actually. So we talked about the edge devices. Okay. So the edge systems perform the tasks of basic analysis or basic of cleaning and filtering at the site where the system resides, okay? Outside the data center, okay? So not everything happens outside the data center can be edge system. Some things are happening at the intermittent situation also, or location, which is called the fog system also. So edge system has been there for a long time. But now we are looking at more volume of data and more capability for the processing also. Now we are doing more analytics. Earlier, edge system was simply a receive and store kind of thing, or maybe transmit to the cluster. But now we are doing a lot of analytics. Sometimes even prediction we are doing at the edge system. Okay, some systems, not everything. So for example, I'm receiving 10 sensors, sensor information. For those 10 sensors alone, you are doing some short-term prediction. The next 1 hour, is it going to fail or like that? That alone, not an integrated level of prediction. Okay. So here are some of the challenges. Okay. So this is very, very important, because lot of manufacturers of devices, storage systems, hard disk and transducers, all these people benefit from the challenges faced in IoT storage. Okay, so first and foremost challenge is the velocity and the volume of data. Okay, so as we have seen, the IoT arena, the volume of data is very much increasing, and velocity points to the rate at which the data has to be processed and shipped. Okay, so how fast you have to get this information and how fast you have to process it, and how fast you have to send it to the cluster. So this is becoming very, very high. Okay, the velocity of the data is very high. So if you look at, let us take a simple example of a Twitter feed. It's not an IoT data, but let's say take a Twitter feed. So you will see millions of transactions per second. So if I am an organization that is trying to understand let's say I'm talking about the educational policy. So whatever education policy related information is coming, I want to take it and store it in my system and then analyze it. So I may have to deal with millions of data every day. Okay. So the rate at which these messages are coming is extremely high. Okay. Suppose I'm taking an example of a media data or a media giant, like for example, CNN or Times Now. They're trying to hone into these tweets of different celebrities and different politicians. So they have to process tons of data every hour. Okay. So the same applies to IoT. So most of the IoT devices are continuous in nature. They are not sensed, or they are not polled every hour. So it's a temperature monitor, or it is the patient vitals. It is actually an analog signal. It is not even a discrete. It's an analog signal. So you have the A to DC, analog to digital converters, that take the data and then convert in digital form and give it to you. Okay. So these are large by volume, and the velocity also is very high. Okay. Second point is that many of the players or the entities that are related to this IoT system, or the systems that process the IoT data, they are distributed in nature. They are not located in one location. They are distributed in nature. So that adds complexity to the entire architecture. Okay. So where do we process the data? Should I process after it comes to the central places, or should I process on the place where the data is residing? So that is called the data locality. So when you have a distributed system, you don't want to send the files from one node to the other node. So if I have a big file, let's say I have a big file consisting of a transaction, this big file is broken into 10 pieces and it is stored in 10 nodes. So this block that goes to that node will stay put. They will not move from one node to another node for the rest of their lives. Okay, so this is called as data locality. Process the data, or whenever you do a program, you send the program to the node so that block is actually processed. You are not bringing the, so that is what we used to do in the olden day client server architecture. All the data come to the centralized server, then we process it there and then send the data back to the, data means the aggregates and the outcomes back to the individual system. But that is not being done now. Now what we do is, whatever data comes as big files, they will stay in the nodes or the Hadoop or the Spark node, and only program goes there and we complete the program there. Okay. It is something like your evaluation centers. So when you have 10 centers, so you go and do the processing there. The bundles stay there. You go and process the data, put the marks and give everything. Then you come. Okay. So the same thing happens in the distributed system. So that adds the complexity to the architecture. Okay. So the concept of data locality is very important. Okay. So this will bring into the topic what has to be centralized, what has to be at the data node level, and what can be clubbed together. Okay. Sometimes aggregated data can be sent to one place. Okay. If you look at the reporting and analytics engine or the layer, the business analysts have got comfortable to processing the data in their own tool. Maybe they were using Tableau or they were using a MicroStrategy. They wanted to continue to use that tool. And they sometimes operated on, and they had a flavor of operating everything from a single database. So the business users have normally a big cloud in the company or the client. So they will say, okay, we want only a centralized server for reporting. So we are not talking about transaction. The transactions are always distributed. IoT data that comes and lands, it is always distributed data. Okay. But the aggregated analytic data. Okay. So what is the total number of customers that are new customers today? Or what is the total sales for the last month in terms of electronics and in terms of footwear and clothing? So this is aggregated information, which is not big data, okay, which is normally of the order of 100,000 records or 200,000 records, which is very, very small. So this can be centralized. Okay. So like that, you have certain things that can be centralized, especially after processing, post-processing data can be centralized. So then we have the challenge of the complexity of devices itself. Okay. So you don't know the number of devices that we have in the world now. Okay. So it could be millions of types of devices. Okay. So different types of camera, different types of transducers, different types of light sensing devices. So like that, there is no end to the type of device that you have. So you have millions of types of devices. Same way, you have different types of formats. Okay. Not of course millions of formats. So you have different formats, like tagged formats. You have sensor have their own formats. Like, for example, it can be simply an analog signal or a pulse code modulated message like that. You have different types. Okay. So these formats also contribute to the complexity of the IoT processing as well as IoT storage. Okay. How do we store? Okay. So another thing is the unit of information also is different. For example, I'm sending transaction data. Most of this data are structured data. So I have a customer format, so it has 10 columns. A transaction format, which has 20 columns. I have the transaction ID, transaction date, customer ID, branch code. Like that, you have certain formatted data. But in the from the IoT, one device may emit whether it is on or off, maybe once in 2 hours. So all you have to do store is one bit of information. On is one, off is zero. One bit of information is what we are taking as the unit of data. Another may be thermal level, okay, thermostat level. So this is, let's say, 97.57 Fahrenheit. Okay, so this is a real number. In another case, it may be a sequence of real numbers. Okay, so the quantity and the amount of data that you are getting for each device is completely different. It's almost like a very, very different formats. Okay, some you may also have video clips. Okay, audio messages, or it could be an image, 28x28 pixel image, or 1024x768 image, like that. Okay, so it is completely different format. Okay, and the type of the data, everything is different. So how to accommodate this in an efficient way, that becomes a big problem. On the one side, I have bits and pieces of information, like 1-bit, 2-bit. Another side, I have video images, MPEG files. Okay, how do we align them and store them? Okay, so you have the concept of slots. Suppose I am storing real numbers in one place, and in the same place I am trying to put an integer. Integer may have 4 bytes only, whereas the real number may have 8 bytes. So I am trying to leave some gaps there. So if I have put only one integer, and the next integer is not available in that particular data format, so that becomes a vacant space. So that will cause some slowdown of the reading speed, and also a lot of scattered data. It is not going to be contiguous. Okay, so that is all going to affect your reading speeds. Okay, so if you understand one thing, the earlier what we are doing was we are having transactions that were happening. These transactions normally got stored in files because you cannot insert them at a very high speed in databases. They got stored in files. Then later they were inserted into the files using bulk load option by removing all the constraints and then doing a bulk load. But now there are efficient databases that have exceedingly high values of write throughputs. So that means you can do real-time data. So I talked about the tweets, no? These tweets can directly land into a Cassandra database or a MongoDB database. So the write speeds are extremely high. Okay. So the write speeds have been increased tremendously. So now we can store them. We can store them directly. So whenever we try to fit this data into such databases or files, we will have to store in an efficient manner. Okay. So the complexity of the devices and the format of the devices, they pose a challenge for the storage. Definite challenge. So a lot of Western Digital and SanDisk, all these guys are actually doing a lot of research how we can efficiently store IoT data in their systems. Okay. And also the frequency of getting the data. So some data may be continuous, some data may come once in a day, some data can come once in 2 minutes, like that. Okay. So this will also pose two problems. One is how much data to be stored, analyzing, and how to store. That is one thing. And second question is, how should I create my jobs? Okay, so should I send them directly to the cluster, or should I have a window? A window is a streaming window. So every 10 minutes it captures the data, aggregates the data, and if the aggregation crosses the threshold, then you have to send to the cluster. Otherwise, you can discard it in the edge node itself. So like that, lot of complexities will come in how you want to design your jobs for different systems. Okay. So if a system is going to give pulses every 1 minute or every 10 minutes, and this needs to be maintained only once in a week, you don't have to bother to send it to the cluster immediately. You store the data for 1 week. After 1 week, you can send it to the cluster, which it processes and sends you back. So like that, your jobs themselves will have to be designed according to this kind of frequency and the volume of data. Okay. One second. All right. Okay. So another thing is where the data has to reside. That is a big design call. Where the data has to reside and how long it has to reside. And suppose I have multiple villages, data from multiple machines or multiple villages. Should I combine all of these and send? So like that, there are so many design questions that you have to solve. Because in many of the IT companies, be it applications, be it data warehouses, or be it data lakes or anything, lot of times the redesign happens because they have not understood the data well when they designed it. I have seen lot of data warehouses, big multi-million dollar data warehouses go down the drain because it's something like tailors and patches. Okay, so something will go wrong. Some architect will come, he will be asked to solve the problem. What he will do is he'll create a new database for that. So like that, whoever comes, they will put a database there and go. Okay. So what happens is after a few years, it will become like a shirt with the 5 patches or 10 patches. So the same data is there in multiple places, okay, in the data warehouse. So the same kind of problem will come if you don't design the system well. Okay. So what will happen is there could be delay in taking the data, delay in analyzing it, and duplication of data. So all these have to be avoided by putting more thought before deciding. So how long it has to reside, where should it reside? All these are big questions. If you do it wrong, then it will cause a lot of data anomaly and data issues, and also cost to the company. Okay. Second thing is, certain abiding by regulations and also ownership. Okay, so some of this information can be owned by multiple entities. So sometimes it can be shared by the government, it can be shared by a company and a centralized body. For example, bank means you have the RBI. Same way, there are some regulatory bodies are also there. Okay. So some of the data has to be divulged to them. Okay, so there is a ownership issue with respect to the data. Okay, so one is ownership, second is sharing. So you may own the data, but you have to compulsorily share with the things. Okay, so for example, in healthcare, for the government and non-governmental organization compliance, you have to send all those information, HL7, HIPAA information like that. Okay. Many more. So another important thing is the privacy related information. Okay, so a lot of times, if the data happens to be related to a individual or his transaction or his amount of money and all, it is actually illegal. Sometimes it becomes illegal, and you have to strictly follow the regulations. Otherwise, you can be sued. Okay, so that also comes in. Another thing that is not stated here is the security, data security, which you are going to talk about in the afternoon at full length. Okay, so the data security is very, very important as well. So almost all the security rules and other things will apply to IoT also. Only thing is, it becomes all the more complex and difficult because most of the time it is always on the move, and the format is different. And sometimes at the edge nodes, you cannot protect the data. There is no system to protect the data at the edge nodes, because until the data goes into a security layer, you cannot protect it. Okay, it is always possible to get it outside. Okay. And also data tampering can happen as well. That is also something that we have to take care of. So this slide talks about the private cloud and public cloud. Okay. So what are some of the factors that govern where whether you have to put it in private cloud or public cloud, etc. Okay. So some of the aspects like location, management, who will manage and who will have the data governance, and cost advantages. Okay. So one simple thing I'll tell you. So I think you can use that as a baseline for deciding whether you want to have a private or public cloud. Okay. So the earlier days, we used to use cloud as mainly for infrastructure or platform. I want a deep learning machine now, I can go to cloud. Okay. But now we are also going to cloud for functionality. Okay. I want to have a blockchain capability. If I do it on my own, it's going to take a lot of time. So let me take the AWS blockchain capability. Okay. So like that, there are many functionality driven cloud offerings. Okay, we take the cloud for that. So now, most of the time, we do not want, let's say our need is only 20 nodes. I'm selling some products. Let's say I'm running a gift shop. And it is online. My clientele is around 10,000 clicks per day. Average 10,000 clicks per day. Sometimes it goes 20,000, sometimes it goes 5,000, but on average it is 10,000. So I assume that 20,000 is my load and I have a need for 20 nodes. 20 machines I will have for my distributed system. But during the Christmas, New Year, Diwali time, definitely it is not going to be 20,000. It may even go to 500,000. I do not know. So for those 2 days, I cannot put 100 nodes. And after the Diwali, okay, I'll use it for next Diwali. I can't keep aside the machines. 100 nodes I cannot keep aside. I will be running into loss. So at this time, whenever your peak load is beyond what you can handle, you want to use the cloud. That is how many companies take a decision. Use the private cloud for whatever you can. When load increases beyond or functionality calls for, you use the public cloud. Now the problem is how to transition. I cannot log in at the time and create 10 machines. The same load can suddenly come. Let us say there is an event, suddenly there's a celebrity event or a political event, something. So more people want to buy gifts. Okay. Or results came for a particular exam. So more gifts like that. Okay. So we cannot anticipate. The main thing is we cannot anticipate when it's going to happen. Okay. So what we do is this has to be done online. It has to be done dynamic. So what we normally do is we have what is called as two things. One is the serverless architecture, and also the other is you can create dynamically more nodes. So the load drives your nodes. Suppose you have up to 20,000 transaction, no cloud usage. But when it goes from 20,000 to 25,000, that 5,000 transaction you can't handle. So for this alone, this is called cloud bursting. Only for this, the cloud will be used. So the load will drive the serverless operations and then you can get the output. Or at that time, you can actually you can have a threshold for your 20,000. So instead of when it crosses 17,000, spawning can happen, which is basically a software service that you want to have. So your software is already there. So you can spawn the machine in 1 minute and you can get it. That is one option. Or you can have a serverless architecture where only the load drives your network. So the processing nodes are already in the backend for the Google or AWS. You are not charged for that. You will only charge for the load that you are processing. That is called the serverless architecture. So that is normally the common thing they use for deciding how much should be on the cloud, how much should be on the private cloud, and how much on the public cloud. And there is a security talk that is always there. So that is something that has to be handled as well. Okay. So if you have it on your system, it is definitely going to be cost effective. But if you do not have IT people or IT team, then you have to again ask the question, is it better off to have it on the public cloud, etc. Okay. So we also have multi-tenancy where in a public cloud, if you have a multi-tenant node, suppose I want to take a node. So they are saying that this node is going to be $2 for a day, okay, or $2 for 1 hour. But if you accept a multi-tenancy, it will come for $1.5 per hour. So what multi-tenancy means, in your the same machine that you are using, somebody else's program may also run. You don't have ownership of the machine. Okay. That means you are not the sole owner. It's something like you have a shopping area where two or three shops can be there in one place. Okay. Sometimes if you see there may be a vegetable shop, in the same shop they may be selling something else also, pharma product. Okay. So they are actually multi-tenants. So that will come for a cheaper price. Okay. Okay, so let us come to the core of the storage. So here, some of the storage considerations. Okay, so scalability is one thing, very important. So whatever system that we are talking about are having two important things. Three important things. One is scalability. So that means for low loads, you can have fewer machines. When load increases, you should have more number of machines. So if you just have less load, I will just survive with two nodes. When I have more nodes, I can have 100 nodes or 200 nodes. So the scalability should be linear. That means when more nodes come in, the cost should be linearly increasing. The performance also should be linearly increasing. That is the linear scalability. Okay. And there is no limit to the scalability because it is horizontal scalability, not vertical scalability. Okay. Second thing is high availability. There should be always, the system should be always on. Okay, so how it is possible? Because sometimes the system can crash. So this is possible by having duplicate servers. So normally we have data in three places. Suppose I have a file. This file will be available in three places. If one place is not working, I can use the second place or the third place, the nodes. Okay, so high availability is a de facto standard for the distributed systems. It can achieve high availability in different modes, but most of the time it is through replication. Okay. So other options are master-slave option, mirroring option and all. But mostly in a distributed system, you are using replication with a replication factor of 3. Okay. Third is distributedness. So scalability and high availability itself means we are having a distributed system. Okay. So consideration, other considerations are whatever we already talked about. Large volume of data, high velocity of data, different formats, different frequency of access, and different types of devices. All these things add to the storage complexity as well. Okay. So normally, the storage system should be having large capability or throughput, and they should be distributed in nature. Okay. For small companies, it may not be a need, but for large companies, definitely with multiple nodes. That's a typo there, I'm sorry. Handling high velocity, very, very important. Okay, so we are looking at a large number of records that are coming per unit volume of time, okay, per hour velocity or per minute velocity. So normally when you talk about streaming messages, we are talking in seconds. Every second, millions of transactions per second like that, okay. And the same data can also come from multiple sources. For example, you are looking at a particular news, you are waiting for a particular news about some election announcement or something. If you are very, very obsessed with that, you will see that the news comes from multiple channels. Suddenly one guy tells this, okay, this is the result. And within 2 seconds, you can see some thousands of messages coming like that. So you have to sometimes manage different formats of these messages and then make sense out of it. Okay, so consolidating the data is very, very important. Okay. So why we have to consolidate data? Here, there's a very important time parameter called as schema drift. Okay. So when we have some data, let us say I'm just taking data from three devices. Okay. So first device is giving me binary data, 0 or 1. Second device is giving me integer value, okay, which is below 65,536. And the third one is giving analog data. Okay. So now, when we have such kind of different things, I will have columns. Okay, so let's say this is a Boolean flag formation. So we call it as on-off state for a transducer one or a sensor one. Like that, you have some column names and data types. Suddenly, let's assume that there are two more switches. From one system, there are only three sensors. From another system, there are five sensors. So they have five columns. Okay. So now you are having a change in the schema. So normally, how we in the olden days, how we design is, we will say, okay, we will understand that maximum schema is five columns. So we'll design for five columns. The two things where there are no sensors, we'll put it as null. That was the old rigid flat design. But now most of the data we are sending by XML. Okay, we're sending by XML. So XML or JSON, so it takes care of the nested structures, missing structures, everything can be handled. But if it is going to land into the database, again, the problem comes. Okay, so a lot of new systems, open source systems, come with what is called as schema drift handling. That means even if the schema changes, the system is not going to break. It can seamlessly understand there's a drift, and it can create an additional column and then load it to the data. Okay, so for example, one of the system is the stream sets. Okay, if you look at the open source tool called stream sets, the prime selling idea of the stream set itself is schema drift. Okay, so that is also something that we want to plan when we are trying to look at the storage. Then the real time, so these are some additional considerations when we want to design our architecture and also the storage locations. Okay, so one of the key tasks that we do for based on your IoT is the real time decision making. Okay, so for example, whether I want to need one more container or not, I am trying to send parcels. Okay, two different cities. So normally, the more containers you send, the costly the trip is going to be. Suppose I am sending all the couriers to Bombay from Delhi. Okay, by flight or something. Okay, one container I am talking about. So how I should manage? Should I add one more container, or I should confine myself with the first container like that? Okay, so the positioning of this package is very much calculated, and they do it actually. So if I have some real-time advantages and gives me very early how I can actually put these things in the container, then it can give me a very good benefit for me, because otherwise I'll be sending two containers when it is only required to have only one container. The same goes to seating arrangements in a flight. So you may think that a lot of seats are vacant, sometimes I didn't get the window seat and all, but there in the flight, the positioning of passengers, if the flight is not full, is very, very important. If you wrongly place two or three persons in only one side, then it can actually cause an accident. Okay, so this is also done by an AI program. So in the front and back, how much weightage has to be there? In the left and right, how many people has to be there? So that is done by a program. A AI program allots the seats for you. Okay, not the specific seat, but the number of the places where the occupants have to be there, not the individuals, but the occupants. So how many, suppose in a flight there's 100 seats, if only 70 seats, 70 passengers traveling, where should I put these 70 seats? Okay, where are the 70 occupants? So this is also analytics. So this is going to take 10 hours or 2 hours to do it, then you will not start the journey at all. It has to be almost like on the fly. Okay, so a lot of times analytics have to happen in the real time, not after 2 hours. Okay, and this also involves message queues, RabbitMQ or MQTT, Lightweight Sense or IBM message queues, etc. And the concept of storing and forwarding. Okay, what data has to be stored? Okay, and where, how long it has to be stored, when it has to be stored, and how much of data has to be forwarded. Okay, so again, it is not like the data that you store should not be forwarded. Okay, some data will be stored and forwarded. Okay, it is not like only one copy is there, it is like you have multiple copies. Okay, and also it has to sometimes operate in a feedback mechanism. So you are sensing the temperature of a room. If the room's temperature is going high, I need to increase the cooling. So you also have to send back some information to the actuators or the taken the data from the sensors, and it is going to either an edge node or the cluster. So once it goes to the cluster, it has to be replicated. Okay, so the replication happens in a background. Replication happens in the background. So normally the concept of rack comes in. Okay, so suppose you have 10 or 100 computers, these 100 computers will be in 10 racks. Each rack is a metal shelf where it is ergonomically designed and environment friendly, and it has high reliable power supply and high reliable internet. So in one shelf there are 10 computers. Let us assume that all the three copies of your data is in the same rack of 10 machines. So node 1 to node 10, you are putting all the three replicas. For some reason the power supply on the rack goes down, or the network of the network cable, somebody just tripped on the network cable. Let's assume that a maintenance guy went there and tripped it. All the three copies will be lost temporarily. Okay, so to avoid this, we have what is called as a rack awareness. Okay, so if a cluster is rack aware, it will not put all the three copies in the same rack. It will put at least one in a different rack. Okay, so two in one rack and one in another rack. The same applies to different data centers. If you have different data centers, it makes sure that one copy is available in at least one other data center. So at this time, the replication factor will grow to 4. The replication factor will be 4. This is only for mission critical data. Extremely important critical data, you want to have a replication factor of 4. Okay. So we talked about the high availability and the scalability also. So this is the Gartner's magic quadrant, okay, for file systems and object storage. Okay, so you have the four quadrants: challengers, leaders, visionaries, and the niche players. Okay, so you can see that Dell, EMC, IBM, okay, Scality. So these are all in the leader quadrant. Okay. So this is for 2019. So we can also get the similar information for the 2020. So this is available with Gartner for all kinds of technologies. Okay, technologies and software and hardware and also other appliances. Okay. So they take companies that have at least a minimum number of customers and have some kind of showcasing of their strength actually. So this is the typical IoT system that we talked about. Okay, so you have sensors and actuators, and you have edge systems. Okay, then you have fog computing layer. Okay, so normally there will be an edge system at the place where you have sensor also. Okay, so there will be three locations, at least logically there will be three locations. Physically there may be two only, but logically there could be three layers as well. Okay, so sensors, edge nodes, fog computing layer, and the data center. Okay, So the data center is normally distributed. It's not like a single set of computers, or even you can have multiple data centers. So this is a typical software service complete system, a comprehensive system for the IoT. Okay. So some of the important players are the data ingestion layer, edge analytics layer, device manager. So in each edge, edge system, you'll have these components. And then at the data center, you have system-wide analytics and a dashboard or control station. So which is also called the NOC system. Okay, so people will be looking at it continuously. And you want to have the business intelligence insights, which is normally done on historic data, okay, not immediately. And you have the IoT stream actually, okay. So as I told you, IoT data is bidirectional. Sometimes you may have to send back the data also to the things. So these can be connected to several sensors and several systems. Okay, so it is a mesh of different systems. Okay, because for example, suppose I want to know whether the flight is in a safe state, I will not have a single sensor that is saying it is a safe state. I have thousands of sensors together after the integration, and along with the data that is coming from the control tower, you will say, okay, it's in a safe place now. Nothing to worry. Okay. So it is actually a complete mesh of systems. Okay, so we'll quickly talk about some of the steps to select the right database for IoT. Okay, so I'll put the word data storage. Okay, data storage and not database. Okay. So first we have to identify the needs, data needs for our solution. Okay, so everything is driven from the problem that we are trying to solve. Okay, so maybe we are trying to create a continuously running system with analytics like that. So you will have a business need that you are solving. So that we have to understand. And what are the data points that you have for that? Okay. And then break down your solution into independent software services. Just like we talked about, what are the software services that will fit into this system, and analyze what is the storage need. Okay. So then we have to group the different services that are having similar database needs or data needs. And then maybe you can combine those services and have a single data storage for that particular layer. Okay. And of course, you have to evaluate the functionality first, whether your solution meets the functionality need, then efficiency need, then the cost need. First comes functionality, second comes efficiency, third comes the cost. For some client, you have to do at any cost. You have signed a service level agreement, then you have to honor that, otherwise they will fine you. So irrespective of the cost, you have to take it, okay? So these are the important services, the data ingest layer, we know what it is. Edge analytics, okay? So basic analytics we can do on the edge data, okay? So normally the edge analytics need may be very less. Okay, so you may want to have a smaller or a lighter database here, because you are getting only data from that particular source. You may not have too much of data, and the amount of analytics you do may not be too much. For example, at the data center level, you may do monthly analytics, you may do analytics across multiple regions or multiple vendors like that. But in the edge, you will only say, okay, so is the system stable or not? That is your only goal. The system stability may be whether the temperature is high or pressure is high, or if any of the sensor is down. So those are the basic analytics you are doing on the edge analytics. So for the edge analytics, your requirement for throughput as well as requirement for the amount of analysis that you are doing is very less. So you can get away with a small light thing. That is why even the processing is a microcontroller. Most of the places, if you see, it is a simple microcontroller, or sometimes even less than that. Okay, a simple card can be sufficient for that. Okay, so the database need at the edge analytics is very light. Okay, So you have the device manager, okay, which mainly communicates to the other devices and other systems, okay. So here the goal of the database is just to access and deliver the messages or signals across the multiple devices or multiple systems, okay. But the main requirement here will be the latency should be less, because it has to be traveling at a very high speeds, okay. So here you have to have high write speeds and high read speeds, not much storage. So then we have the centralized system-wide analytics. So this performs whole lot of data analytics. So you may have to store the data in a historic way. And the main need here is the analytics capability or the query capability and long-term storage. So this is typically like a data warehouse need. Okay, so you want to have long-term data retention and have multiple dimensions stored so that you can do analysis across multiple dimensions like state, district, and time, monthly or yearly or annually, like that. Okay. So the dashboard is going to display only data for some duration. So let's say the data every 10 minutes, it's showing the dashboard of a number of devices that are currently working in a green level, that means safe. Orange level, that means on the threshold of disruption, that means temperature is growing a little. So suppose the maximum withstandable temperature is 80 degrees centigrade and temperature, normal temperature is 50. If it crosses 65 and between 65 and 70, it may be in the threshold of disaster. So you will have to have orange light there. And then once it crosses 75, immediate action, red color like that. Okay. So dashboard, the amount of data is less. It is only the current slot. Okay. At maximum, current slot and previous slot. Compared to the previous slot, compared to previous 10 minutes, the amount of passengers requesting cabs is higher. So it has increased. So that increase or decrease we want to know. So two slots maximum. So the need for dashboard data is very less. Okay. But the data should be accurate. That's the main thing. And sometimes the time span will be very, very critical. So I want to have it every second or every minute. Like that, you may have some time requirement. So that means if it is, let's say if it is a critical machinery, you need to have it every second. On the other hand, let's say there's a weather station. You want to have it only once in a day. Okay. The dashboard that says whether the machine is working or not. But the weather station that you are giving the weather report or temperature and pressure report, that may be continuous. Okay. So every 2 seconds it gets updated. So BI is a historical layer. So it is exactly the data warehouse. You need fast queries. That's the only requirement. So IoT stream outlet, okay. So here we have to push them to the subscribers. Sometimes what happens is there may be a data point, and this data point, there may be different subscribers, okay. So you will have to send this information to people who have subscribed to this data, okay. So they may be from different government organizations or different primary health centers. So you may have to send this particular information to everybody. Okay. So mainly we work in two modes, the publish and subscribe mode. Whoever is subscribed, we will send to them. That is one option. Other option is we are acting as a system to push the data to another system at a high speed. So here we don't do the work of publishing and subscribing. Instead, what we do is you have multiple receivers. Let's say there are 10 receivers are there. You have to send all your information. Let us say I have to send data at 100,000 messages per second. So I have 10 consumers. I use a queue system. First consumer takes some data. Second consumer takes some data. So just like I'm giving away some balls to people. So whoever can take 10 balls, they take 10 balls and go. The next person comes and take, like that, from a bucket. Okay. So the same way we use the queue method. Okay. So queue method is also possible, but most of the time we work in the publish and subscribe method. Okay. So these are some of the factors that should be considered while choosing the database. Most of them we already talked about: size, scale and indexing, and is it effective to handle high throughputs? And schema friendliness may be used sometime, but sometimes you may be able to handle any kind of schema. Portability and type of language that it supports. Okay. For example, if a person is very comfortable with MySQL or Oracle, he will find it very difficult to work with MongoDB or HBase. Okay, because the query format is different. Okay, HBase uses get and put messages, whereas MongoDB has insert and find commands, and it has collections. So process modeling and transaction, and what are the different types of data that you are going to use for integration, that is going to be very much different in IoT. And is there any need for time series analysis? Okay, so if you are going to be predicting temperature spike based on the past outcomes, you can use the time series analysis. Okay, and archival process, security and cost. So these are some of the considerations for deciding a database. Okay, so this is a diagram from Redis. Okay, so this talks about what is the data lifetime for different systems. Okay, for some systems or for some of the type of data, the data lifetime will be short, but for some system it will be long. For example, the business intelligence is a historical data analysis system, so it will be having a high retention period. Same way, system-wide is also going to be a daily or a weekly thing, whereas the data ingestion and other things will be mostly for very, very short time. Okay, so they don't have to reside in the edge node or in the cluster for a long time. Okay, so this also decides our size of the database. Okay, so cost factors, there are different costs that are there for the database. So license cost can be there if it is a proprietary software, which again may be either a CPU based or based on the size or based on the number of users or consumers. Infrastructure cost and data loss cost. Sometimes you will sign an agreement or SLA with the user or the client, in which case you have to bear some cost. Okay. So,
sir, I have muted. Once again, you unmute yourself, sir.
All right. Okay. So sometimes there may be data loss. So data loss sometimes comes with a heavy fine. Okay. So if you have signed the service level agreement, then you are responsible for paying that money. So in such case, you can take insurance. It is also possible to take insurance. And there are ways to compute the cost of this loss cost. Okay, operational overheads, maintenance cost, all those things are there. Okay, so here this diagram mainly talks about two types of databases. Okay, one type of database is called hot database, the other type of database is called as a cold database. So hot database is the database which has time critical data, time critical data. That means that has high velocity data, which has a very low time for outputs to be received. Okay, for example, I have to make analysis every 10 seconds. I have to make analysis every 10 seconds. That means that database can be considered as a hot database. Okay. So cold database is the database that is having a long retention period, and the time is not a critical factor there. Okay, and also the data retention is longer. Okay, so these are actually some types of databases that are available for ranking. Okay, so if you go to dbrankings.dbengines.com, you can see the following list of databases: relational database, key value stores, document store, time series, and wide column store. Okay, so you can see the rankings also of them. Okay, so I was planning to show it to them, but due to lack of time, you can just check it out. Okay, dbengines.com, and then or search on the Google DB rankings. Okay, so that will give you and every month it rate increases or decreases. Okay. So this explains the hot database and cold database. So one of the solution for hot database, because of a very, very short time duration of retention and also for high speed of processing, what you can do is you can build use the in-memory database for this, if it is possible. That means the entire database resides in memory. Okay. So many databases have come with that option, in-memory database. Okay. So for example, SAP HANA is an in-memory database. In open source tool also, a lot of database or programming constructs that help in-memory database, like the data frames, they help you in achieving this. Okay. So they need to have extremely high read and write speeds. That is the main criteria. So cold database refer to the normal databases, which can use typical slow processing of query, which can use MapReduce or Spark engine like that. So these are some additional database considerations while using: flexibility of data formats, query capabilities, and supporting of messages and queuing system. So some databases come also in tiered model. So for example, one layer could be more costly compared to the next layer. So frequently used queries you can keep in one tier and the others can be pushed to the second tier. Okay. High availability is extremely important. Okay. And safety of the data, binary safety. So this lists some of the databases: MongoDB, Cassandra, HBase, Bigtable, Waldremort, Redis, etc., and the types that I've mentioned. So this is used for general systems. Okay. Some of them can be used for IoTs also, but there are certain databases that are very specifically designed for IoT. Of course, you can also use a lot of the cloud offerings. So I have pulled some 3-4 databases that are very frequently used for IoT. One is the InfluxDB. Okay. So it was released in 2013 and it is based on Go programming language. Okay. It is a key value database actually. So key value database stores key values and the details. For example, I have country and the country detail. So country will be unique key and the details will be the value for that. So it is going to store like a hash table. It is extremely fast to be read. For example, I want to store hour. So the hour means date and hour. For the last 100 years, I want the temperature of Delhi. Okay. So I can have a key value store containing the date and time as a key, as a single element, single integer value, a big integer value. And corresponding to that, I have the temperature, pressure, wind chill, etc. Okay. So if I store it in a key value store, anybody anytime wants this value, they can browse it extremely fast. Okay. So Redis also is a key value store. Okay. InfluxDB, even HBase can have a key value store effect actually. So InfluxDB is primarily operating on the that parameter. Okay. All right. So let me just go back 1 second to this slide. Okay. So now, if you look at, let me go to that website.
Kannan sir, if you feel so to relax for 5 minutes, you can give a break for 5 minutes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. I think in the benefit of all the participants, you'll have a five-minute break.
Join back.
Okay, 12:05.
Dear participants, I request you to have a break or a refreshment. After 5 minutes, we can continue. Now it is exactly 12 o'clock. Probably 12:05 to 12:10, we can start. Sir, I request you to put a 10 minutes break or 8 minutes break in the annotation somewhere. Then only then they will understand. Some of them are going away from session sometime. Kannan sir, I request you to annotate 10 minutes break somewhere on the screen.
Okay, can we continue?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We can proceed with, sir.
All right. Thanks for the break.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's go to this link. Okay, so this is dbengines.com. Okay. So this is the overall list. Okay, so they use a method to calculate the scores depending on the number of users and the projects that are being there and number of tickets, etc. Okay. So this keeps changing, just like the stock exchange, the rating for these databases keep changing. Suppose if I want to pick a new database for my project, so let's say I want to create a document store. I can go to document stores. So I can find out the top databases and pick one of the top things. Okay, so you can see that you can see the RethinkDB is there. Drill is there, Apache Drill is there. MongoDB is on the top for a long time. Amazon also comes with the DynamoDB. Actually, DynamoDB is very, very important because the database called Cassandra had its roots from DynamoDB also. Okay, so some of the architectural aspects are from here. So you can choose the right database for you from your business use case. Okay, so that is the one thing that you want to do. So I am sure most of you know the important database. So let me put a list of databases types actually. So we are familiar with the relational database model. Okay, so we have our big players, Oracle, MySQL, Microsoft SQL Server, then DB2 from IBM. Then more popular is MySQL. Of course, you have Sybase, Informix, Postgres, etc. But these are the four commonly used relational databases. So most other databases, they fall into what is called as NoSQL database, most of it, okay? So NoSQL database has to be thought of as not only SQL. Or a better replacement for NoSQL will be a non-relational database. Okay, so we are not very clear about what is the type of language they use, each of them use. So you can think of a NoSQL database as a non-relational format. A relational database has rows and columns. We all know that. So just like an Excel spreadsheet, it has rows and columns. Whereas non-relational database has different methods. Okay. So in non-relational database, there are four important categories that are very much used in the modern architecture. The first is the void column data stores. Okay. So the databases that fall into this category are primarily Cassandra, HBase, Google's Bigtable, and some of the others. So here, there are a few important properties or features of this database. Of course, all of these are scalable. All of these are highly available. Okay. The first and foremost important difference from a relational database is that this actually stores the data in a column format. Okay. So what do we mean by that? Okay. So suppose I have a record. Let's say I have a table that contains customer ID, customer name, sales amount, discount, etc. Okay. So let us assume that I have such columns and many other columns. Okay, I have these few columns, but many other columns are there. Okay. So how the database stores this, RDBM stores this, first it takes the first row. Let's assume that there are totally 80 columns. It takes the first row and stores all the columns contiguously. First row, all columns contiguously. Then it goes to the second row. Then it goes to the third row. So like that, it writes the data to the file. Essentially, all database is basically a file only. It is going to store in a file. So you will see data like this. You will be seeing data like this. So this is the first row. It has columns. Then you have the second row. So like that, it stores. So when you want to access, let us say I want to access some of the sales amount. Okay. So let us say sales amount is here. This is the sales amount. So if you look at the columns themselves, some columns are character fields, some are integers, some are Boolean, some are real numbers. Okay. Like that you have. So to pack a single record, it is really difficult to pack record one single record in a single contiguous memory is really difficult because it is something like arranging in a big cubical box, small box of different sizes. You will always end up having some free space. Okay. And second thing is, suppose I am trying to look at a particular business requirement. So let's say total sales amount by product is the report I want. So product is product category is electronics, food and beverages, clothing, etc. And the total sales amount. So here I'm only using the sales amount column to add and then other column to group. So I will be actually getting only two columns for the report and I have to extract the two columns from these 80 columns. Obviously you can see that it is going to a particular place and picking columns and coming out. Okay. So this is going to be slow if this is the requirement. But if my requirement is to read around 50 columns and put some data on it, then this will be good because I am looking at the majority of the columns. But if my requirement is just reading sales amount and grouping them, this is not the best way to store. The best way to store would be then just to create one column for sales amount and store all the rows continuously. Okay. So this is the sales amount for the first row, sales amount for the second row, sales amount for third row. Like so this is in a file, not in a database. This is in a file. So it is continuously present. Or you can think of it this way. Now, if I want to add all the sales amount column, piece of cake because it is stored in contiguous locations, all are of the same data type. So it will be packed correctly. Same sized box, you want to arrange in a truck or anywhere, you can easily fit in absolutely well. Okay. So the columnar database is very efficient in some business cases. What business cases? When we are performing operations on only few columns. And that too, I want to do aggregation of the whole column for all the records. If I want to only get a sales amount for food and beverages, then columnar format is not good. Columnar format is good when you want to aggregate all the records, no filtering, okay? So Cassandra and HBase is falling on this type, okay? So the read speeds and write speeds will be extremely fast, but you cannot do filtering. You cannot only do partial aggregation and you cannot work with multiple columns. If you want to have multiple columns to be done, better bet would be the relational database. Okay, so that is one aspect of it. The second aspect is, so this is very optimum for high speed reads and writes when you have only few columns. Second thing is, schema friendliness. In RDBMS, if I have a table consisting of 50 columns, then every time I have to provide the 50 columns. I cannot say these columns are not available for a long period, okay? So it is expecting all the columns to be present. But in this type of database, columnar database, column families are there. Column family, okay? So you have what is the column family. So when I create a table, I can say create table sales, and I have column family one, column family two. This is my create table script. I don't have to specify the columns. So column family is like a column group. Columns are created at runtime. You don't have to create the schema upfront. Okay. You don't have to create the schema upfront. It is something like you are going to jungle, wherever you want to put your tent. Just like that, you can put your tent. And then when you want to go again, you can fold the tent and go. So ready-made house, okay? Same way, all the columns are just created on the fly. You don't have to create a schema upfront, okay? So that is a very good advantage when you know that I may be getting some data for which I do not know the column names upfront. Suddenly, there may be a new transducer introduced. Suddenly there may be a new column introduced into the particular data. So this will be very good for columnar database. But if you are using relational database, then you have to go to the DBA guys and make the change. It is going to be a big process, okay? So that way it is very, very useful, okay? So column families are used for creating. And then dynamically, whenever you insert a column, the column gets created, okay? So because the data is stored not like rows and columns, so it doesn't matter whenever a new column is created, it'll just store it at that particular point, okay? So you have HBase and Cassandra. So again, there's a difference between HBase and Cassandra. Two important differences. One is, HBase is very rigid in terms of inserting and getting data. So you insert data or cell. So you can think of Cassandra and HBase as consisting of cells. So each cell is identified by So here is the cell. So let's say the cell has a value of Hyderabad. Okay. And it's identified by these things. Table name, column family name, column name, row ID, and timestamp. So these five things, of course, if you remove the table name, it will become four things: column family, column name, row ID, and timestamp. So this forms the unique index for the column. So the database, HBase and Cassandra database, are automatically sorted according to this key value. Automatically sorted, okay? So anytime you insert a record also, it will get automatically in the right place. It's automatic, so it will auto sort, okay? Based on the index, which is column family, column, row ID, and timestamp. So this timestamp is a unique concept, not done in this one, RDBMS. So here in the same cell, you can have multiple versions of the data. Suppose this person moved from Hyderabad to some other place, okay? So let us say earlier he was in Bangalore and now he moved to Hyderabad. So the older version was Bangalore, new version is Hyderabad. So now I have two versions. So I can get either Hyderabad or Bangalore based on the timestamp or version number. So first version is Bangalore, second version is Hyderabad. I can have one more version of Delhi or New York, okay? So this is the versioned database. The database is the versioned database. And that is one difference, okay? So that is one thing. So the H-based query language is very complicated. It uses only get and put commands. And whereas Cassandra operates in two modes. You can use the get and put commands also, but it also has what is called as Cassandra query language shell, SQL SH is there, which gives you the interface or client similar to RDBMS. Just like you will create a normal database, you can create a database also. You can create a normal database also, but it will be in the architecture of Cassandra. Okay. So that is why a lot of people prefer Cassandra over HBase. Okay. Cassandra is one of the two popular NoSQL databases are MongoDB and Cassandra. Very, very powerful and popular. Okay. Okay. So Bigtable is the cloud Google version of the thing, and Google Bigtable also accommodates the Google Maps. All the data of the Google Maps is in the Google Bigtable. Okay. So this is one category. The second category is the MongoDB category, which is the document store. So here, when we say document store, we are not talking about a store for storing Word documents. Okay. So here, when we say a document, it is the JSON document, which is actually a binary JSON. Okay. So let us say I have in XML, I put a book. So this is the data for book. I am just giving you XML. If you want, we can convert to this one JSON also. So book has some constant elements, author. And we want a title also. Okay. So sometimes the authors can be two authors, three authors. So you can have multiple elements for author. Sometimes you can also have nested structures. Okay. For example, let's say same author only. Or let's put a different column, just forget about book. Okay. So name. So name can have two elements, first name and last name. Okay. All right. So like this, I have the data. So the same thing can be first name, last name is also there. I'm not putting all those things. So you can have nested structures. You can have multiple times the name. You can have sometimes in some books, authors may not be there like that. Okay. I'll just complete it and convert it into JSON format. Okay. So both are tagged actually. Okay, so this is the JSON format. Okay, Java Server Object Notation for the same data. So as you can see, the tags come only once in the JSON format. So that is a huge saving in data transmission. So whenever you're transmitting data, For XML, every tag you are going to send two times, the beginning of the tag, end of the tag. Okay. So that is the problem with the XML. Okay. And also this one is more program friendly. This is like a C or Java syntax, so very easy to use it. Okay. Use and do the coding. Okay. Whereas this one is a little tagged format purely and not in a programmable format. Okay. So this is called a document. So the good thing about MongoDB is that it does not need any schema. Okay. So this is the document store. So two important advantages of document store is, first is schema friendly. So you don't have to create a data of particular schema. Anything you can just send it. You say, okay, this is my data, just take it and it will load it. So what it does is it simply takes JSON format and stores it. No big deal, no? You have a JSON data. So what it does is it keeps it as a data, that's all. And to the front of it, it adds an index, underscore index equal to, which is a 16 character or more number, okay? Like this, it'll put an index, hexadecimal, I think. So that means A, B, C, D, E, F, L, all these things will come. So just I'm giving an example. So it adds this index and then puts the data. So if I want to do query, I can only do a find. Find all the records or all the documents with the first name equal to Kiran. Okay, I can do a find like that. So I can add the same data 100 times also, because this index is the unique ID. So whenever you are inserting, so it assumes that documents can be duplicates. For example, I am going and buying a Coca-Cola from a shop. I drank it. I said, okay, I thought it's good. So I buy one more time. So two times I'm buying the same thing. So if I have only date as the entry, no timestamp, then I would have two entries by the same customer also. Okay. So it allows duplicates, but it identifies by the index. Okay. So index is automatically generated column. All right. So that is what the documents are. So the second advantage or the main advantage of document store is it looks at data as real life objects. Okay, so let us say there was a problem from one bank customer. There's a problem from one bank customer or a vehicle. Okay, let's take bank customer. So this bank customer, the manager wants to know about this bank customer. So he asked the person who is in the IT team, can you give me the details about this particular customer? Sir, then 2 minutes later, he comes back. Sir, this bank customer has 3 accounts. Which account do you want? He needs all the accounts, right? So if you want to delete or get all the details of this customer, you have to join with multiple tables. Current account table, loan table, then credit card table, and also the KYC table, like that. There are many things. So if you take RDBMS approach, this will take a long time to join and do it. It's a design job, okay? Whereas in MongoDB or the document store, what we do is we store them as objects. So when I send details for Kiran Kumar, I'm sending credit card account, loan account, current account, everything I'm sending, it is storing. So I put the name as Kiran Kumar, all the things I get, just like I will get a file for this person, okay? So it is closer to real life objects and it does not need joins. Okay, no joins are required. So it is going to be extremely fast in getting the data. In RDBMS, we have the third normal form or the star schema model. So always we have to rely on joins. Okay, so that may be good in many cases, but in bad, in performance related things, it will become a bad thing. Okay. So these stores are very, very useful because they store objects in a real life mode. Okay. So that is why most of the things that you will see in IoT based databases, they are all either key value store or the document store. Okay. So the third category is the So if you go here, you can see MongoDB is number one, Amazon DynamoDB, etc. Same way, white column stores, Cassandra, HBase, CosmoDB. Data stacks is getting very popular now. Okay, data stacks is very, very popular. Google Bigtable, they only use it, but very, very powerful. And then third object is the key value store. Redis tops the list, Amazon DynamoDB. So some of these databases are multimodal. They can be key value and document or document and key value like that. Memcached was very popular earlier on. React also is good. LevelDB also, we have talked about in the other DB, InfluxDB. So you can also create your own database if you want. Open source is available, make functional changes and you got it, okay? All right, so the fourth database type is called graph database. Okay, so graph database assumes that objects are represented in a graphical mode. For example, LinkedIn friends or hierarchy of employees or the different countries' capital and their bus routes like that. Okay, so you have different points and some property to connect between these two points. Okay, for example, from here to Delhi, it is 2,500 kilometers. So that is the property. One more property, okay, maybe from Bangalore to Delhi, the charge is 4,500 rupees by flight. Okay, so that is the property. So I can connect all the airports and have a property of what is the charge or what is the distance or what is the flying time. So I can do all my queries based on this only. So to represent this, you need vectors. You need vectors. So graph database basically uses vectors. So the different vectors are created and then it is very, very fast. Okay. So most of this, what we are talking about is actually available online on a cloud also. Cloud or this one. Neo4j is available, MongoDB is available on cloud. You can create your own cloud account and test it. If it is you like it, then you can work on it. So same here is the MongoDB cloud version. So I have created a small cluster consisting of two machines. So in 1 or 2 minutes, you can create your cluster. Cluster of so this is the Neo4j, which is basically connection of points and their properties. Okay, all right. So key value store is a very simple database. Okay, so it simply has keys and values. Okay, for example, 123 is the customer ID. I have the customer details, Kiran Kumar, premium customer, Bangalore, 23 age. So like that I have, so this is the key and this is the value. So what it does is it indexes by key and accesses the values in a high speed way, super fast way, okay? So most common database is Redis, okay? Most people use Redis. Memcached also is there, all right. So let's go through some of the data. InfluxDB is one of the databases used in IoT. Okay, so it's a key value store and also it has time series in it, okay? So that is another important database model. It stores time events. Okay, so suppose the temperature of a city in different hours, or the stock price in different minutes or dates like that. Okay, so these are some of the time series. So Druid is another important database. InfluxDB is there. Prometheus is there. Okay. So Amazon and Azure also provide their version of it. Okay. So you can do time series prediction using the ARIMA models and other things. So it is very useful actually. Okay. Only restriction is one of the domain has to be the time. It could be date or minute or hour like that. Okay. So InfluxDB stores time series data as well. So using a key value pair. Okay. So any kind of time series forecasting, you can use this. So some of the advantages: index support, and it also has SQL like query language, which is very helpful. Okay. So if you are working with the time series data, you may have some in-between misses. Suppose, let's say, one day I forgot to take the temperature of a particular place. So it can do the interpolation and fill those values. It is something like predicting the in-between value. Okay. And it can also perform aggregation operations. Second type of database is called the CreateDB. CreateDB, I mean, not CreateDB. It is also a distributed SQL database. Okay. It's open source and it's written in Java. Okay. So some of the components or functionalities from these applications are also available. So Lucene is a search engine. Elasticsearch also is a open source search engine. Okay. So these components are all part of this or built on top of the same thing. Okay. So mainly it is created for IoT in mind primarily. Okay. So a lot of companies have used this in the beginning, CreateDB. Okay. So main advantage is the throughput. It has high throughput, millions of transactions per second. And it is having linear scalability. That means if you want more data ingestion, you can add nodes. Okay. And it is very ideal for real-time queries. Okay, so you have very good indexing methods and real-time queries are supported in a great way. Okay. So it can accommodate complex data like geospatial information and AI models. Okay. So CreateDB is something that you can explore. Okay, so that's a good tool. So additional advantage supports ANSI SQL, support for MQTT, okay, message queues. And advantage is that it works with Kafka also. So Kafka is the cluster for streaming and persistence. So mainly its primary role is to act as a broker, message broker. At the same time, it gives persistence. So it has multiple nodes, partition, and it all those topics. And whenever you have some data that's coming in through messages, it is returned to the disk so that it does not get lost. I mean, okay. So Kafka is almost used everywhere wherever streaming is required. Okay. So Kafka is one of the key ingredients of distributed system. So it works well with Kafka. Okay. So that's very good actually. All right. So Kafka, the main words are, I'll just put the words so that if you have to proceed further with more learning, you can use that. So it is a message broker.
Sir, sorry for the interruption. Afternoon, yeah. You have session. Maybe in 5 minutes to 10 minutes, we can wrap up,
yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So it's a message broker, works in a clustered way. It has its own master-slave architecture, where the master is called the Nimbus node. And the slaves are called worker nodes. So a cluster, basically like a Hadoop cluster. And it writes to the log. Okay, so persistence is taken care. And it uses partitions and sharding. That means sharding is also called striping. So when I write data, I don't write only to one node first. I make the reader go to all the nodes and write fast, okay? So that it is, suppose I am putting a file in one hard disk. Let's say it takes 2 minutes. So for the two minutes, are you going to sit and watch or do something else, okay? So that is what is the sharding process. And it works in the publish and subscribe and cue method and uses topics. So these are the key words that you want to know about Kafka very fast, okay, and used for primarily streaming. Okay, it works well with Spark, it works well with Flume and Storm, all those things it works well. So this database works well with Kafka. Next is MongoDB. I know most of you know MongoDB. It's also open source. It is a document store and it's also cross-platform. Okay, it works with the binary JSON objects. So it is very good for IoT because it has no schema and it can take documents directly. And high throughput, so real-time data ingestion is extremely good. So advantages of MongoDB. Okay, most of it we have already talked about. So unique index is auto-generated, no joins required. So another two databases, RethinkDB, it also works with JSON. And it is very high throughput, allows it for real-time data ingestion. Okay. So its query language is very unique and it's adaptable. So it can work with multiple APIs also. Okay. So it has its functional plug and play functionality also. And in real time, without any downtime, you can add additional nodes. Security also is good, so it gives you SSL access. LastDB is the SQLite. SQLite is like a SQL database only, but it's very, very lightweight. So it is ideal for putting on a mobile phone or like Android will be always using SQLite. Again, the main beauty is that you can put in the edge nodes. Wherever you have edge nodes for your IoTs, you can put the SQLite if you want to have a minimum memory usage and disk usage, so that any kind of basic functionality can be done by the SQLite. Okay. So that's pretty much what I have. Any questions so far? Any questions? I was looking at the questions, but most of it I answered, I think. Okay, so one thing that I want to tell you all is, in the earlier days, software was separate and research and education was separate because most of the software are proprietary software and we did not have access. Now, pretty much whatever is the most powerful is always open source. You can talk about Hadoop, Spark, Cassandra, HBase, MongoDB, MySQL, StreamSet, Elasticsearch, NiFi, Storm, Splunk, everything is open source. So there is no distinction now between software engineer and academician. So if you want to become experts or if you want to create your own software, it is out there. You can just go to GitHub or the source code, download it, and you can promote additional functionality, or you can work with some product, or you can provide some services. Because all it takes is, suppose if you are very good in going to the library and sitting there for 2 hours together, then definitely software is ideal for you because you have that focus. You can become extremely valuable in the community. Okay, and IoT is a very nascent and very fertile platform for you to show your skills. And I encourage all of you to download some of this open source software and become masters in that. Okay, because the learning comes by practicing as far as software is concerned. Just like you learn more by teaching, the same way you learn more by doing it. So please feel free to download some of the software and understand the features and see how you can leverage those tools in your career and also in your guiding of your new projects to the students. Okay. All right. Thank you. If there are no questions, I'll stop here and let you go. You'll have your time for your lunch and other things.
Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and delivering the session with the awesome topic, Without DB, Nothing Can Be Done. So you have touched upon all the flavors of DBs suitable to the data generated and to be processed further. So it's a very fantastic. Yesterday we were doing cloud operation and how the communication happens between gateway and the cloud. Today, after the communication, how we can store the data, that is what the connectivity we have brought in. The flow of the session goes very perfect. Afternoon, we do have IoT security and challenges. With that, let us meet by 2 o'clock after the lunch. Thank you all. Kannan sir, thank you for your concern, accepting the invitation and being with us. Really, it was a sparkling moment. Several inputs we have received through your session, that comparative study of all the DBs, the DB engine introduction is awesome. Thank you so much, sir. Have a nice day, sir.
Yeah, it is my privilege, madam. Thank you for the
opportunity. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you all.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you all the participants.
Let us join back by 2 o'clock. So please go for your lunch and sign off. Again, you can join back by exactly 2 o'clock. Thank you all. Have a nice lunch.